Hey guys, I've accumulated a few packages since my last unboxing video, so I think it's time to make one, especially because of the big box on the bottom that just arrived. I'm going to save that for last. First up, I want to take a look at these three items. They're all Admiral TV related. First up, it is the original owner's manual for several Admiral TV models, including one that I happen to have. I believe I have the 26X55, which is actually back there. You can't see it too well. It's barely poking out. Hope to get to that sooner than later. That is my only Admiral TV that uses a 16-inch metal cone picture tube. So I'm curious to show you guys one of those. I've only restored one metal cone picture tube TV, and I didn't do a video on that because it was before I really started doing videos. And it looks like they actually included some service info. I think this would have been just the owner's manual, just this portion. And this looks like it's an excerpt from the original Admiral service info, which is nice. 16 GP4, yep, that's what this set has. That is a 16-inch metal picture tube. So, it's nice to have not only the owner's manual, but some service info as well. I guess it got torn over the years, but this is the full schematic for it. So it'll be a nice little addition to that project just to have some original paperwork for it. Alright. And then there is this little guy, which I guess is a little sales flyer. It's from the early days. Around 51, I think they dropped the cursive logo and with the straight logo. So you see stuff like that, you know it's some of the earlier stuff. But they do mention the 16-inch rectangular picture tubes in this, I do believe, which means probably from 50. Well, it says 2449 on here, so this might be from 49. Let's see what sets this show inside. Oh, no, this is definitely earlier. Yeah, this would be 49 or 48. Yeah, this is the old stuff. So there's the 7-inch tabletop. There they're showing the ebony, which is a 19A12. The much more common is the brown 19A11. It's $169 plus $1.30 federal tax. And here's one of these I've never actually seen up close. That's a combo set that came in a lacquer cabinet with Chinese motif on it. And there's one that's black with kind of it says ebony or jade lacquer cabinet with oriental high relief on both doors. I've seen pictures of both, the black and the green. Interesting look. And then here, this guy looks very similar to one of mine, but this is actually bigger. I have a 30A16, which looks similar, except if you look close, my sets, most of my Admiral sets, console sets, the 10-inch sets have a different mask. When they look like that, it's a 12-inch set, so this would be a 30C15. They call it a 12.5-inch picture. They took a lot of liberties with the picture size back then. That is only 12.5-inch. It's 12 at best. Let's see what else we got. Looks like more of the combo sets. So when they mentioned 16-inch on this guy, that would be a 16-inch round picture tube with a rectangular mask ahead of them. It was just too early for the rectangular picture tubes. That's too bad they don't show the Bakelite console sets. Seems kind of odd. They only show the Bakelite tabletop. They don't show the Bakelite consoles, just the wooden consoles. Even so, neat to have. 1-year warranty. Alright, now this last one is a little bit newer. Well, it says right in the front, 1950, so it'd be about a year newer than this guy. And this one's especially good with a nice large format. The front's even actually embossed. That that image on there is raised up. So it's actually very similar to the first thing I showed you. That model was one of these. I don't know which one, but it's one of these. And the set I have is basically, it's just the left-hand side. It doesn't have the record player and radio. Back, all right, let's look inside. First in 1950. I'm gonna try to scan this. It comes apart, it's got clips on it, so it shouldn't be too hard to pop this apart. I can scan each page individually. This is some really nice info to have. So there's what the chassis looks like with that round metal cone picture tube. Magic mirror picture tube. Not sure what they really meant by magic mirror. Well, let's say guards against glare light as no other tube can, yet maintains true brilliance. Well, all that means is that it has frosted glass on the front, which actually cuts down on the brilliance a little bit. Aluminized is what you really want, but they did not make aluminized metal cone pitcher tubes as far as I know. So here we finally see the emergence of the rectangular pitcher tube. But the larger sizes and some of the economy models, they still had the rounds. The 16-inch and 14-inch rectangular were the very first on the market, I'm pretty sure. Rotoscope antenna, that's just the kind of a cheap antenna they would just stick up on the top of the cabinet. It had a little lever sticking out that you could slide back and forth. That is the rotoscope antenna. And there's a lot of marketing BS about all the features these sets have. Turret tuner built for the future. Yeah, I've mentioned this in some other videos. The tuners, you could pop out the sections on them, and they would leave one or two extra spots like that. Westinghouse have been working on with the thought that you could actually receive UHF through those tuners. Didn't really work out too well in practice. There's the page. The Dynamagic AM/FM radio. Whatever Dynamagic means. New, improved, and better than ever. Increase the selectivity, the sensitivity, and performance range. Admiral's amazing ratio detector FM. FM was a new thing back then. There's phonograph triple play. Do 78s, 33 and a third, and 45 RPM. Miracle tone arm. Play all three speeds with only one needle, one tone arm. Here's the styling that sets the trends. I have some radios in here as well. I've seen these, certainly that model is fairly common. I don't actually have one though. These pages are really nice color, so they're kind of thick and a little hard to turn. Came in ebony, mahogany, and ivory. So circles down here indicate the model number, so that is the 6Q12. And this is kind of a nifty thing. It's I think it's an AM radio record player and a Bakelite cabinet. And that is one set I do not have, and I've never actually seen one up close and personal. Bakelite tabletop 12-inch. I've got some of the 10-inch models, but never the 12. think, yeah, 12x12, I show it here again. That one I do indeed have. It's in my workshop, 22x12, and one of these days I will get around to working on it. I think mine has a bad speaker, so that could be a little troublesome to replace. Here's a wooden version of it, 22x27, blonde wood finish. And here's the console version, or combo version. And there's this variation on it. And there, I believe, is one of the 16-inch rectangular sets. So you see when they have the round pitch tube to increase the viewing area, they use a double D mask so it's rounded on the sides, whereas a rectangular, they don't do that. So a neat thing to have. Just so you can see why I want to scan this, is to share it with everybody because it's such a nice quality thing. Alright, now moving on to the boxes. Okay, let's start with this guy. I think this has some tubes in it. So I've been having trouble recently with the last few sets I've worked on with them being very picky about 6BG6 horizontal output tubes. So I figured I'd better pick up some more. So I took a chance on eBay and bought some. Oh, no, that's not what this is. That's what's in the bigger box. No, this is something I hope I will never need, but when I saw it and recognized it for what it was, I had to grab it. I think I was the only bidder. This is a genuine Philco replacement horizontal output transformer and coil, which I do believe, when I googled that part number, is compatible with some of the Predicta models, particularly, I think, the Holiday. And, pedestal set. In other words, the 21-inch sets, but not the tandem. They use a different one. And it sure looks like one to me. As I say, I hope I never need it. But I still have some left to restore. And, you know, hopefully, like I said, nobody else bid on it, so maybe nobody else recognized it for what it was, but even if I never need it, somebody else might be good for doing some trades or something. In fact, as I said before, I've never found a bad flyback in a TV. But that can't last forever. I've certainly suspected them on a few sets, but it turned out to be other issues. And I think the reputation for Predictus having bad flybacks is a bit overblown. I think what people see is that the coating comes off and they think it's bad, but the flybacks are actually fine. I've had to recoat all of mine, that's for sure. This should be 6BG6 horizontal output tubes. Oh, yay, peanuts. We got these from SingTube at frontiernet.net. I'm not sure what they are on eBay, but that's their email address. So it looks like I got three of them. I think these are new old stock. RCA 6BG6G, still in original boxes. I think these were from an estate of a TV guy. Let's see these now and then on eBay. You'll see one vintage TV item, and then I click on other items from the same seller, and if they have a whole bunch of TV stuff, it's usually because it's from the estate of a retired or expired TV repairman, and they put them all up on eBay. So I'll have to check these for sure, but I have high hopes these really are new old stock, and they'll test great. Sure look unused to me. Very pristine looking. And I guess somebody did test them at some point and wrote the numbers on there. Going by the info on here, packed in 1959. So, surprised they were still making them in this style in 59, because I've seen newer ones, GA types, that have straight glass sides. Because by 59, they really weren't using these in TVs anymore. They would just be for replacement purposes. Alright, so, next, this little guy. Totally stumbled across it by accident. It's the only bidder. Maybe these are common, maybe I overpaid, maybe I got a good deal. I don't know, because I've never seen one for sale, I don't think. But when I first saw it, it looked kind of familiar, and then I had to check the number on it and verify that it is what I thought it was, and yeah, it was. It is a Philco battery. I seriously doubt it has any charge left in it whatsoever, but what is particularly nice about this is that it's for something that I already own. And I'm hoping that I can maybe re-stuff this box. I've actually seen one of these up close and personal. Looks like they're probably not too hard to open up. Either carefully pry this end to open, or maybe slit this top and pop it out. Huh. Looks to me like they clipped this out, and this part would have gone with the radio, and the battery would just have the female side of things. That's on the tape. Alright, anyways. So, what is this for? Well, I will show you. I finally got that out, and what it's for is this, the Philco Mystery Control. I may use it for other items as well, but for sure this is one of the uses for it. So that is cool, very cool, because I do have a radio that uses the Mystery Control as well. I've not restored it, haven't done a video on it yet, but one of these days, hopefully all of these pieces will come together, and I'll have a functioning Mystery Remote Control and a functioning Mystery Receiver Radio. Now, from a little research online, it looks like the original battery that would have come with this actually had different graphics. It said Mystery Control on it. But the connector matches and the battery model number matches. So, neat thing to find, I think. Alright, that just leaves the big box. Condition of this item is a little sketchy. And I have no idea what the condition of the insides is, so I'm prepared to be a little disappointed. I knew I was taking a chance on it. But still come up for sale too often, and when they're in nice condition, they tend to go for a lot of money. And it's a tough thing to ship, too. But I know one YouTuber who's got one, or at least had one, that was in really, really nice shape. And I was kind of jealous. But at least I've got one to play around with my own, finally. So what it is Philco 7008. So there she is. Not the greatest condition, missing a few knobs, but one of the things that really attracted me to it was it has the original probes. One of these will just be a straight through probe, called the low frequency probe. The other one, high frequency, has a detector diode and some filter circuitry in here, I believe. Sure, you could make one and cobble one together on your own, but I thought it was a nice touch to get the original. At least I think that's the original. As I can tell. And then here it is. I think I'm missing a crystal that might have gone in here, if that's what that's for. I'm not entirely sure. Actually, now that I look at it, I don't know what that's for. It doesn't look like a... I thought it was a crystal socket at first, but there's not really holes behind there. Huh. Well, I don't know. So, if you've seen me do alignments before, you know I use a separate sweep generator and I use one of my scopes in XY mode. Well, this can do it all. And if you get it all calibrated and set up right, fairly accurate. So here's your sweep generator. Set your range and set your center frequency. Set your sweep width. Set your output levels. And then you connect the output of your device under test to the input here. And you view the resulting response curve up here. And it also has built-in markers. And this is the key. If you got accurate markers, this doesn't matter so much, as long as you get sufficient sweep width, because this will actually tell you at various points what the exact frequency is. And they do have built-in modes for marker calibration against a crystal inside. You can beat against that, and you can see the result of the beating on this, and use that to check the calibration on the dial. And they also have some tricks and tips for using both the dial in the background and the lines in the foreground to do interpolation to help you correct for deviations and get dead on with the frequency. Now, you may notice, hey, there's no CRT face in there. What the heck? What's going on? Looks like there's just a piece of metal back there. Well, yeah, that's one of the novel things about this. I mean, the whole thing's kind of novel. I think there's only one other sweep generator I know of that had a built-in scope, and it was not this compact. And the reason it's compact is because when you use it, you swing this out. I put the camera down, see if I can get that out. I should have known better. I was just reading the owner's manual for this. Before you pull the back out, you gotta pull this forward. And yes, I do have the full manual schematic, a really nice condition, really detailed service info, how to check out to make sure it's working right, and then how all kinds of tips on how to use it. So with this pulled forward, this should now swing. Good deal. And there is the CRT phase. So, question is, what is the condition inside? I'll show you some of the service info on this. And so I mentioned other YouTubers got one of these. That was Shango66. He does a video on his, which looked to be in fantastic condition. Can't remember if he operated it or not, but he went through a bit how it works. And one of the keys to this whole thing is, how do they sweep the frequency? More modern sweep generators use something like a varactor diode. It's a device where the capacitance varies with applied voltage. So it's just like rotating manually a variable tuning capacitor. You can do it electronically with a ramp tooth. So as you get sweep the screen from left to right, the frequency goes up in your oscillator. Well, they didn't have those when this was made. So what did they do? Well, basically they took a speaker voice coil assembly, attached a metal plate to it, and used that to make a variable capacitor. So as the voice coil moves in and out with an applied sine wave, it varies the capacitance, varies frequency of the oscillator. That's how they do the sweep. So for this to work right, that thing has to be operational. And I would imagine over the years, with a lot of use, they'll start deteriorating. So fingers crossed the mine's in good shape, as well as the CRT is still good, power transformer and all the rest of it. Here is a nice high-res scan of the schematic for the 7008. And this is the marker oscillator, which is a highly... All right, let's take a look at the schematic for the 7008. This is a high-res scan I found online. Up here, there is the high-frequency probe. And the regular probe. And here is RF generator and marker oscillator. Looks like they use a 6J6, I think. And a 5 megacycle crystal. I think that's built in. That's what you use to beat against the variable RF oscillator to calibrate it. Down here is that magical sweep generator. And this crazy looking thing is that voice coil variable capacitor. So driven by sine wave. Let's see, what's this driven by? 6. Oh. I presume it goes to a... Oh, they do use a sweep oscillator, okay. I thought it was to be a tap off the power transformer, but it's phasing control and blanking. I mean, it might be derived somehow from the actual line voltage, I'm not sure. I would think they would, because generally you want it to be 60 hertz and fairly accurate, so when you hook it up to other equipment and you adjust the phase, things work out all right. Anywho, so sweep this at a really high frequency. I forget what the exact values are, but something like 100 megahertz to 200 megahertz. That's probably not quite. Oh, actually, see right there. 140 to 250 using a 6AK5. And then they mix that down to get the lower frequency ranges. It's much easier to get a wide sweep with if you use it at very high frequencies and then mix it to down convert it rather than trying to sweep over a wide range of lower frequencies. And there's power supply and high voltage stuff for the CRT, 3MP1. I don't think I have a replacement 3MP1, although I've collected a lot of CRTs over the years. Don't think I ever found one of these. I believe they're rather short. So even though that swings out to accommodate it, it's still one of the shorter 3-inch CRTs around. See, so they got some loctals in there, as Philco like to use. Now, what I don't see on the schematic are voltage values, because I'm putting together an order with Mauser Electronics, because I want to get a 0.47 picofarad cap for my Westinghouse project, and I want to fill out that order with other stuff. So I was looking through this, and there's no voltages spec'd on these electrolytics. So I figured, well, I'll go to the full service manual. I found that online easily. Very detailed about theory of operation and how to actually use this thing, how to calibrate it. So these are the kinds of curves I expect to see on that display. So S curves for aligning discriminator coil, or a narrow bandwidth IF or a wide bandwidth IF. Let me show you some typical TV schematics and where you would hook this up and how you would use it. I'd do stagger tuned IFs, sound IF, video trap, all kinds of good stuff. And then we get to this with servicing info, calibration instructions, and diagrams of the inside. So I'm going to open this up in a separate video soon, but here's a taste of what things look like inside. And I want to open it up soon. I'll clean off my workbench, because even when I looked at this and you get the parts list, they don't have the voltages for all the capacitors. Like the C103 condenser electrolytic, that's used for the high voltage for the oscilloscope, just a 15 microfarad rather, no voltage. They do for some, but not others. And when you get to the film caps, or paper caps, or whatever they use, they don't have voltages on any of them. Don't think they have wattages on the resistors either. So here's the caps, 0.05, 0.05, 0.02, 0.25. No voltage rating. So I think either I can look up these Philco part numbers, we're going to have to locate each one of these capacitors one by one and check out the voltage. Probably 630 would be good enough for all of them, except maybe the ones around the oscilloscope circuits. I might need to go 1,000 or 1,600 volts for some of those. All right, so that is going to be it for this video. I hope you enjoyed this look at some of my latest finds. And I'll be looking for a dedicated video on the Philco 7000A real soon. I hope none of you have left any comments yet, because I can correct myself. That is for the logo. I finally realized, hey, that looks a lot like this, which is a little Philco scope. So this nice logo would have been on here, and I do not have the high frequency probe. What I've got is the input and the output, which is great because those are really strange looking connectors. And this is not a high frequency detector. This is likely an attenuator inside of here. All right, so that is going to be it for this video. Be looking for an in-depth 7008 video really soon. But for now, I hope you enjoyed this look at some recent finds.